Okay, so last time we finished. So what did we do last time? Yeah, we talked about trace and categorical dimension, pivotal and spherical structure. Okay. Okay, so today we will talk about semi-simple multi-tensor category, but before that, we need to introduce some notion from group theory. So the notion of G-torsor, we will need a bit later. So, so you consider a group acting on a non-empty set. So here are some leçons, ça. Are some well-known notion from group action of group. So and the action of the group is transitive if for all two elements in the non-empty set, there exists an element of the group from which you can go from one to the other by the action. So transitive in particular. Yeah, the orbit of any element of the set is everything. Free, so what is free? So for all elements of the set, X, if you have two elements of the group G, such as the action of the group on X, the action of G on X is equal to the action of H on X, then H equals G. Okay. So for all X. So finally, if an action is both transitive and free, the set S is called a G torsor. Okay. So this is what I wanted to define here. Okay. So here is an example or an exercise. So you consider two pivotal structures in our category. So here C should be. So what is C? Spherical tensor category. Let's say. The spherical tensor category. So two pivotal structure. So the exercise say that to show the existence of a monoidal functor from the identity of itself, such that you can go from one pivotal structure to the other. So it's this is a transitive structure, because this is exactly what we get here. And we may have also some free structure. So so if so you have two monoidal functor like that, such that you have this equivalence. For all pivotal structure, then these two monoidal functors are the same. So this is also an exercise, so it's transitive free. So in that sense, so which is stated in the book like that, the set of isomorphism class of pivotal structure on the spherical category or the pivotal category S C is a is a torsor of this set according to this definition, so it's a free transitive. So here see the pivotal structure, and you can make the same remark for spherical structure where you replace this set by this set. And you consider only the order two element. So anyway, I may need that later, so I don't remember. Okay, so now, semi-simple multi-tensor category. Okay, so as usual, you start from a field which is algebraically closed. Okay. So semi-simple multi-tensor category. You take. So here, semi-simple mean every object is a direct sum of simple objects. So you consider an object, then the left dual is equivalent to the right dual. The left dual equivalent to the right dual. Okay, and then the the object is isomorphic to its double dual. Okay. So this is important. So as usual, because it is a review part, I skip the proof. Okay. So very important. Thanks to the semi-simple assumption, we have these two isomorphisms, which are not true in general if you don't assume semi-simple, of course. Okay. So I skip the proof. So as I said, this is false without semi-simple assumption. So you can find a counterexample in the book at this reference. Okay. So you see. This isomorphism was is a necessary condition for the existence of a pivotal structure because the pivotal structure is a natural isomorphism between the identity functor and the double dual functor. So you need to have this isomorphism. So it's a necessary condition for existence of pivotal structure, but is it sufficient? Okay. In fact, so this is a very famous open problem. The existence of a pivotal structure, so assuming semi-simple. So does every semi-simple tensor category admit a pivotal structure? This is not even known for the more constrained case of fusion category over the complex field. It's not known whether it admits a pivotal structure. And same admission of a spherical structure. What is known is in the unitary case for fusion category, because unitary implies pseudo-unitary, which implies spherical, which implies pivotal. So the unitary case, in the unitary case, this open problem is known because we have all this implication. Okay. So we can ask some other more question. So without considering the semi-simple case, we can ask whether there exists a multi-tensor category with this assumption, but without pivotal structure. So you can, you can ask some question like that. It's okay. And finally, so this proposition. So you consider a semi-simple tensor category. You consider a simple object. And some isomorphism between this object and this double dual. And so the proposition is saying that these two traits are non-zero. Okay. 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 So this proposition show that in this case, if you raise the pivotal structure, the dimension defined above cannot be zero. But in some other case, for example, some non-semisimple case, you can have this dimension to be zero. Okay. For example, when you have the, you consider a representation category of a finite group over a field of positive characteristics dividing the order of the group. Okay, so this is exactly the same proposition as stated before. Okay. 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 So I skip the proof. So as I said, this is not true without the semi-simple assumption. You take a finite group representation over a finite field. Here, the field of P element. So you have, you take this representation. This representation has a dimension zero because P is equal to zero modulo P. So this counter example can look a bit too easy, but in fact, there also exist counter example over the complex field. Without semi-simple assumption. Okay. So now we will consider the Grothendieck ring in the semi-simple case. And we will see what are the additional algebraic structure of the ring thanks to this assumption. So we already know. So we already defined the notion of unital Z plus ring before. So now we will define the notion of based ring. So this requires some extra assumption. So you consider a Z plus ring, the basis. And E0, so E is the index set for the element of the basis, and E0 may be the index set for the element decomposing the unit object. So here, the coefficients are non-zero. So all the unit object by assumption can decompose as a positive sum of elements of the basis, non-negative, sorry. So for the set of index for which it is a non-zero is I0. And you define this group homomorphism using I0 like that. So it's one if I is in I0 and zero otherwise. Okay. So you take a Z plus ring with bases like that. So such a Z plus ring is called a based ring if there exists an involution. So involution means if you apply two times, you come back to the initial index like that, such that So that it induces like that an anti-involution on the algebra. So you define the involution on the index and you can induce it on the algebra like that, because star, and you just put a star on the index like that. And the assumption here is it should be an anti-involution, which means an involution. So you apply double star, you come back to A, and when you apply one time, you just you permute. So A B star is B star A star. So this is the first assumption. And the second assumption is the following. So tau of bi bj is one if j star equal I and zero otherwise. So that look like to the Frobenius-Perron to the dual assumption in fusion ring, but it's more general here. Okay. So, so here I forgot to say that this tau is defined like that, but it's also in, then it's induced by linearity on all the algebra. So this is what you get here. You have bi bj can be decomposed, and then you apply this formula and you should get such a Okay. So so this this statement, in fact, this means that this tau can detect whether two elements of the basis are dual or not. So then you get a based ring. Okay. Okay. So some basic result on based ring. So the star structure's involution is stable on the coefficient for the unit, which means that if you have an element which you have an index in I0, it's dual, is also in I0. And in fact, the unit is exactly the sum of all the elements of index in I0. There is no coefficient. The coefficient here are one. Well, if this is non-zero, then this is exactly one. Okay. Okay, so I skip the proof. Now, the tau of AB equal tau of BA, so it is a trace. Okay. And tau of A star equal tau of A. Okay. And now we can define a inner product or a bracket. I don't know if it is as the structure of vector space, but you have this bracket of these two forms. You have two elements of A, and you define tau of B star A. So this is very usual in operator algebra. You have a finite factor. You have a trace, and you define the inner product like that. Usually, okay. So this lemma is saying that this inner product is symmetric. So you can permute B and A. Okay. Now, this proposition is in fact, this is about the fusion coefficient. So this is a fusion coefficient. So if you talk, you think that as a, so you have a multiplication, so it's a base ring, it's a Z plus ring, so everything decomposed like that. And in fact, the multiplicity here is exactly, come exactly from this inner product given by tau. So the multiplicity is exactly that. So you, it's exactly how many times BK appear in the decomposition of BI BJ. You just make this inner product like that. And you recover the Frobenius reciprocity, which is the so you have the usual fusion coefficient, and now it is equal to these two other fusion coefficients. What is the process here? If you put a star, then you permute the two, and if you put a star here, you permute the two like that. So this is the Frobenius reciprocity. And so again, you can prove in this case the Frobenius reciprocity for the base ring. Okay. So I skip the proof. So this is mainly based on using this inner product. Okay. Okay. So maybe, so here we proved the Frobenius reciprocity, but maybe, I did not check, but maybe you can reformulate base ring just by being Z plus ring plus Frobenius reciprocity as stated here. So we know that one way is true because we just mentioned the proposition and we, here is a proof. But I guess, I did not check, but I guess the other way is also true. Okay. So here we know that the associativity is equivalent to have this to be the, a matrix representation of the algebra. And the Frobenius reciprocity here, we know that it is equivalent to get the fact that the matrix adjoint of that is a matrix, the fusion matrix of the dual. Okay. So now we can provide some more specific algebraic structure, which will correspond to the Grothendieck ring of a multi fusion category or fusion category. So that's why we call that multi-fusion ring or fusion ring, because this will be the structure of the Grothendieck ring of such category. So a multi-fusion ring, so it's a base ring as defined above, plus extra assumption that the base is finite. And a fusion ring is as like that, plus the assumption, plus the unital assumption. The unital mean that the unit object is simple. So the unit here is in the base. Okay. okay. So here is you can make a central element from any element. From any element, you just make this sum of, so it's like an action by conjugation. So you make this, you take this element and you multiply by bi on the left and by the adjoint like the dual on the right, you make the sum on the basis, and what you get is a central element. Okay. So the proof reduced to considering the fusion coefficient, the Frobenius reciprocity. So it's the proof is very short. Okay. So now let us come back to category. So we define this new algebraic notion, and we will state the result about the Grothendieck ring. So you start from a semi-simple multi-tensor category. Then the Grothendieck ring of that is a base ring. So if you replace multi-tensor by tensor, then the Grothendieck ring is unital. So you see the difference make the unit object simple. And if you start from multi-fusion category, the Grothendieck ring will be a multi-fusion ring. And from fusion category, it will be a fusion ring. So the and remember that when we started from a multi-ring category, what we get was with left dual, I don't remember, what we get something that was a C plus ring, something like that. So we have three levels of category, ring category, tensor category, fusion category, with or without multi. And this corresponds to three types of ring, Z plus ring, base ring, fusion ring. Okay. So what about this remark? What is the mark is about? This remark, what is saying? So if you apply tau on an element, it reduces to make the sum of all the coefficients corresponding to the index set of the unit. In particular, when you are in the unital case, which means this I0 is of cardinal one, the trace is just taking the coefficient of the unit object. So this is exactly, this corresponds to that. So the multiplicity of when you consider B, V is the object of the category and B is the element of the Grothendieck ring, this is exactly the multiplicity of the unit object in V. Okay, so as usual, such propositions are optimal in the sense that it is false if you don't assume, for example, here semi-simple. If you don't assume semi-simple, you can get a unital case where you have here you have something greater than one. Whereas in the semi-simple case it should be equal to one. Okay. So you have okay. So we saw in some example for which it is equal to two. So the equality, the one should be one. Where is it written that? I don't remember. Where the assumption, the one assumption. Here, I guess, yeah, maybe. Okay, so. So we can make some counterexample. As I said, we find a group over a field of positive characteristics. So this is a family of counterexample here. If you are interested in considering the smallest possible such counterexample, you take p equal 2. then in that case, the order of this group is that, p squared minus 1 times p squared minus p. So if you take p equal 2 for both for the group and for the field here, you get a group of order 6, a non-commutative group of order 6, and we know that there exists only one non-commutative group of order 6, which is a symmetric group S3. And so you have this, So you have such counterexample. You can find such counterexample for very small group, the smallest non-commutative group. Okay. Now let us mention example of multi of what? Of semi-simple tensor category. So example of semi-simple tensor category. So you consider the Lie algebra SL2 over the complex field. And you consider the category of finite dimensional representation. So it is well known in Lie algebra. It's a semi-simple tensor category. But it is not a finite tensor category because you have infinitely many simple objects. In fact, the simple objects here are classified by irreducible representation of FL2C, and every such representation are indexed by a natural number, and the dimension of that is just m plus 1. And for m equals 0, this is the trivial representation. Il y a encore du bruit. OK, on est combien là? On est 3. Cool. Okay, so this is a well-known example of semi-simple tensor category. And if you're interested in the tensor structure of this category, so the Grothendieck ring is given by this rule. So you take two such simple objects, you make the tensor product, and it decomposes as follows. So the sum for L equals 0 to the minimum of I and J of V index I plus J minus 2L. And the dual structure here is trivial. So you have this Grothendieck ring of this semi-simple tensor category. So you get a base ring. A unital base ring. Okay. So here, let me mention. Yeah. So this section is is not too much developed in the book, but it is important for my own research. That's why I will develop a bit this part. This is very important for categorification problem. When you start from the fusion ring, or more generally from a base ring, or even a Z plus ring, when you want to make categorification, you need to solve the Pentagon equation. and the variable of the Pentagon equation are F symbol. So let me define, let me go into more details about this Pentagon equation of F symbol. So you start from a semi-simple tensor category, as before, as for SL2 representation. You consider the simple object. You consider the home space. So here, this corresponds to the multiplicity. It's more or less a multiplicity space of this simple object in this tensor product. So the dimension of that is exactly the how many times this simple object appear in this tensor product, in the decomposition of that. Okay. So this tensor product of object is equivalent to a direct sum of simple object with the multiplicity space. Okay. Now you make, so Pentagon equation is about associativity. So here you have two times to make the tensor product of three simple objects. You can first do this one and then this one, or first this one and then this one. When you do that, when you apply this formula in this case, you get some different multiplicity. So the multiplicity space will be of same dimension, but in terms of home space, you get something different here, here. And the associativity constraint is saying that you have a collection of linear isomorphism between these two space. So you have this space and this space, and you have isomorphism. So this isomorphism are labeled by four indices corresponding to three for this simple object, I1, I2, I3, and the fourth one for where you make the direct sum, like that, over I4. So you have such isomorphism. So a collection of such isomorphism. Okay. Now, if you consider, so this is like a big matrix. If you consider this block, so making the the mapping this, so you fix J and you fix L, and you consider the block going from that to that. So you have some big matrix like that, and you consider just one block. So then you have a block. So you had two new indices. So you get six indices, and this block is called the 6G symbol. So this 6G symbol is well known in physics. In fact, you usually find this notation 6G symbol. So this is exactly that. This is exactly the one component, one block of the associativity constraint. Okay. Okay. So now, now everything was based on this home space. So you can specify, you can choose a basis of this home space, and then you can consider every entry of this block individually by fixing this element of the basis of the home space. So you get six for the block, and four here, they are index of simple objects, and these are correspond to morphism. They are morphism in the basis of the home space. So you have six indices and four of simple object and four morphism like that. And this is an entry of this block. So it's a scalar, it's a number. And this number is called the F symbol. It's one F symbol. Okay. So in some good case, so I will not go into the details here, but maybe you can depict this F symbol as a tetrahedron, like that. So you have the simple object corresponding to the edge of the tetrahedron, and the morphism here correspond to the vertices of the tetrahedron, like that. And you see alpha, for example, correspond to this indices I1, I2, j, and you see I1, I2, j. And same for all the other beta, I4, I3, j. So we have beta, I4, I3, j. So it's in the good case, you can write. So basically, when you are in a unitary fusion category, let's see. You fix all the, maybe for this is true for something weaker than that. Maybe, anyway, for sure, for unitary fusion category, you can do that. So, this F symbol can be represented like that. Okay. So, if you are in the multiplicity free case, which means that every Ohm space here are one dimensional. This is a definition of multiplicity free case. Then you have no choice. Every such Ohm space are one dimensional. So you don't need to specify the morphism. And so the F symbol depends only on the six indices like that, and so in this multiplicity free case, the F symbol are exactly the 6G symbol, which is a case for the example we mentioned before, SL2 over the complex field. The 6G symbol are exactly the F symbol, but in general, it's not true. Okay, so I will make the pause. And we will talk about the Pentagon equation after the pause. Okay, so we defined what are 6G symbol and F symbol, and we mentioned what is the usual way to depict the F symbol in some good case, for example, a unitary fusion category. Now, what about the Pentagon equation? So the Pentagon equation is an equation where the variable are the F symbol. Not this one. So the Pentagon equation is an equation where the variable are F symbol, and it's a polynomial system of degree 3 of the following form. So you see here the F symbol are written like that. So we write, so this is one F symbol, one F symbol, one F symbol, one F symbol, one F symbol. So it, you see, this is variable. So it's degree 3 here and degree 2 on the left. So it's a polynomial system of degree 3. So this is exactly the Pentagon equation. So, but it can be, you have a lot of F symbol and even more Pentagon equation. It's an over-determinated system. So if a solution of this system provide a categorification of the base dream, if it exists, it may not exist. Okay. So, okay. So there is a way to fill all the blank here. So you can do that as an exercise if you want. So pictorially, you can replace every F symbol by such labeled tetrahedron, like that. So they are labeled as above. And in fact, you can see these two, the left-hand side and the right-hand side, as two ways to evaluate some label triangular prism. So this graph is a triangular prism. Again, you have a label for the edge and vertices with morphism and simple object. And you have two ways to evaluate this triangular prism. And these two ways provide this pentagon equation, this equality. So this is a recent work we did with Liu Shangwei and Yung-Xiang Ren. And the way to understand these two ways to evaluate is the following picture. You start from a triangular prism and you so this is intuitive way to understand the two, how to evaluate here. You start from that, and this, in fact, topologically, you can, this is equal to this. You are, alors, est-ce que tu m'as mis comme co-hôte? Non, tu ne m'as pas encore mis. Ça y est. Tac, tac, tac. So sorry, my internet connection just cut. So I'm just come back. Okay. So as I said, you start from this triangular prism graph. How to see that the same here? Because you see, it's just another way to see it. You see, this is the same as that, but you watch it from above, in fact. Okay, and here you make an evaluation. You get two tetrahedron, or you. You go from there, you make one evaluation, you get that, and you get one evaluation, you get three. So in fact, the evaluation, it's related to the, you have three parallel. Anyway, don't go into the details. This is an intuitive way to see how you can evaluate this in two times, of course. This was done in detail in this paper, and this requires a lot of details, many, many pages. But this is okay. So this is a Pentagon equation and its pictorial representation. Okay, so now we will review the section about representation category of Hopf algebra we did last semester. Okay, so so the ID here is the ID. The ID is to start from tensor category or ring category and to go to Hopf algebra. And for going from one to the other, we need the notion of fiber functor. So we will define everything, what is Hopf algebra, what is fiber functor. What we know is tensor category. so this will be, you will have several characterization theorem. In fact, all these characterization theorem will say that more or less a tensor category of algebra is the same thing as a tensor category with a fiber functor plus some extra assumption. I don't remember the details, but this will be a review soon. So what is the point here? You have, in fact, in the abstract of the course is written that fusion tensor category or fusion category is the representation, can be seen as representation of theory of quantum symmetry. So here, Hopf algebra is one example of quantum symmetry, but of course, you can have more general quantum symmetry. So usually what we call Hopf algebra is sometimes what we call quantum group. So the representation category of quantum group give a tensor category. Quantum group is, as I said, a specific example of quantum symmetry, but you have more general quantum symmetry providing tensor category as representation. For example, you can start from a subfactor, a planar algebra, subfactor planar algebra. You can take representation, and you get tensor category which are not representation category of algebra because you can have one with categorical dimension which are non-integer. For Hopf algebra, the dimension are exact of the representation are exactly the complex dimension of the vector space, but you can start from a quantum symmetry which is not a quantum group, and you know that because it's not, you don't have a dimension which are integer. The category is called non-integral. So in this case, you know that it's a quantum symmetry which is not a quantum group. Anyway, and you can also have quantum symmetry, integral quantum symmetry, which do not come from quantum group also. Okay, so this is a point. So here we focus on, in fact, the point here is to make, to algebra, how to say, to provide model of this tensor category in algebra, because you can, for example, have you can modelize some category as representation of a group, of representation of algebra, etc., etc. So it's a way to provide algebraic model of this category. Okay, and we will see that in fact you have proper algebraic model only a necessary condition to have a proper algebraic model is to be in the integral case. It's not even sufficient condition, but it's necessary. Okay, so let's start from a ring category. The ring category is a tensor category where rigid is replaced by exactness of the tensor functor. Okay, so we want the notion of fiber functor. So first, what is a quasi-fiber functor? So it's a functor from C to VEC, which is exact, faithful, k-linear. Okay. So exact means the functor keeps a short exact sequence. Faithful means it's injective on the Ohm set, and this is a category of finite dimensional vector space over the field K, such that the unit map to the one dimensional vector space, and you have the monoidal structure like that. So a natural isomorphism given by this collection like that. So it's a natural isomorphism, so it satisfies some commuting diagram of a natural isomorphism. But for that to be a fiber functor, you need that to assume some other commuting diagram, not just for the natural isomorphism, but related to the ambiguity given by the associativity constraint. Okay, so this is a diagram here. So if you remove the ambiguity with the associativity constraint, you have a fiber functor. So we already mentioned this before. So in other words, we can reformulate as follows: a quasi-fiber functor. Yeah, is a quasi-tensor functor from C to VEC. Okay. So here are some examples of fiber functor and quasi-fiber functor. So if you start from the category of G-graded vector space, and you go to the category of vector space, so you forget the G-grading. So you don't do anything. In fact, you just forget a structure. This is called a forgetful functor. You can do the same for representation of a group. You go to the category of vector space, you just forget the action of the group. These two forgetful functors are fiber functors. You can do the same for the G-graded vector space. So the category of G-graded vector space with a non-trivial three co-cycle here. And this is no more a fiber functor, but just a quasi-fiber functor, which means that when the omega here is non-trivial, you don't have this don't commute in general. Okay. So this is a bit tricky, but it is interesting, so maybe I will read that. So this complicated part is here to explain why we talk about fiber. Why fiber functor? Why fiber? The notion of fiber comes from topology, and in fact, you have such a structure. Such structure is a generalization in some sense of something you appear in topology. So let me briefly mention what you have in topology. So you start from, you take X to be an Hausdorff connected topological space. So you can consider the fiber functor. So you consider the representation category of the fundamental group of this topological space. And you consider the forgetful functor to the vector space category. Okay. So this fiber functor can be identified with the usual fiber functor in topology. So you start from, so I am not very good in algebraic topology. So I will just read what I wrote without a deep understanding. So you start from log X is category of local system of finite dimensional K vector space. Okay. And a local system is a locally constant sheaf, and a sheaf is intuitively the generalization of the notion of vector bundle. So you have this category. And you go to VEC as follows. Such a local system map to the fiber given by one element. Okay. Anyway. So I will not go into more details here. You have the notion of fiber here. And this map corresponds to this map in some sense. I don't understand in details here. And this is exactly the fiber functor of this example. So this notion of fiber functor generalized. It's a categorical generalization of something coming from topology. I don't go into more details. Okay. Okay. So now we will need to introduce notion of in fact, the point here is that we want to recover some off algebra from tensor category. And in fact, what is off algebra? Off algebra, it's an algebra. You have an algebra structure, you have a coalgebra structure, and you have some additional structure like antipode and like unit or something like that. And so you want now you to make this reconstruction theorem from tensor category with fiber functor and off algebra. We need to recover all the structure of off algebra in the categorical framework. So, and this will be done by the fiber functor. J'ai plus d'encre. Il n'y a plus d'encre. Mon stylo. Okay. So you start. In fact, c'est bon, j'ai été dévissé. The idea here is you have a fiber functor. And you can consider the algebra of natural transformation, or in fact, or not, maybe natural transformation here, from this functor to itself. And this has a structure of algebra, and you will see that it has a structure of bi-algebra. So there is an algebra structure here, and we will see there is also a co-algebra structure here. To do so, we need to recall the notion of Deligne tensor product. Okay, so you start from, so this notion is not a notion about, is not specific to tensor category. In fact, this can be defined for any abelian category framework. So you start from two locally finite abelian categories. And we assume they are collinear. And we want to define a new category, which is more or less the tensor product of these two categories. So here, this tensor product has nothing to do with the tensor product of object. We are making a tensor product of category. Okay, so it's defined as follows. So it's defined by some universal property. So you start from Yeah, so I don't want to go into too much details about that. In fact, so this is given by, so this tensor product is a bifunctor. So from this direct product of category to that, so it's following, defined by the following universal property. So how to do that? So you have some universal property. So you have something. This is what you want to be defined by universal property. So you have something else like that. So again, you have something, some bifunctor, which is right exact in both variables. So you want to define something like that. So you assume you have another bifunctor with right exact on both variables. And you will always get a functor from this to this. So this is a way to define that as a universally. This is, if it exists, and we will see that it exists in some case, the definition of that is such that for all bifunctor right exact in both variables, there exists another bifunctor from that to that. Okay, and it is a universal Deligne tensor product. And Deligne proof that such object defined universally always exists and is unique up to some equivalence. And it is also locally finite. We assume to be locally finite, and in fact, the tensor product is also locally finite. We assume that to be right exact on both variables, but in fact, you can prove that it is bi-exact, not just right exact. And okay, so you have this tensor product of home space is isomorphic to this home space in the Deligne tensor product. And you see here that the so in this Deligne tensor product, the objects are given like that. So I don't go into too much details. Okay. So you have to just to understand that the Deligne tensor product is a universal way to define a tensor product of two abelian categories with locally finite. So if you have another way to define that, another way to define tensor product, then you can recover it from the Deligne tensor product by some projection or something, some functor. Okay. So it's a universal tensor product, Deligne tensor product. So now we have the Deligne tensor product of category. We want to make the Deligne tensor product of functor. So you have two locally finite abelian K-linear category, and you have a functor, right exact functor, and we want to define a right exact functor between these two Deligne tensor products, and we want to define it in some universally. So you can define it using the universal property mentioned before. So you start from the direct product. You apply the direct product functor, and then you apply the bifunctor of the Dolin tensor product, and you get so then what do you do? So you start from that, you have this one, or you do like that, you do that here, you get here, and you can go directly from there to there. So what are you doing? Okay. So this can be defined like that. So this, I guess it is a universal. Oui. So I don't remember this notation. So you go from there to there, and then I understand, because you apply the universal property defined before. You have a map from there to there, and so you can apply this diagram. This is F bar here. Okay, so you apply, you have F, and this is defined universally like that, and you can apply that with F. This F here, you take this, and you have this coming from the definition of the of that by universally. So it's a way to define this Dolin tensor product of functor. Okay. Now, remind 50 minutes. So this will be used to define the bialgebra structure on the set of natural transformation from the fiber functor to itself. So let's come back to ring category. So you have you take C to be a finite ring category. You have a fiber functor. So this is the tensor structure of the fiber functor. So the set of natural transformation from F to itself is denoted like that. So it has an algebra structure as follows. These are natural transformations, so are given by collection of morphism like that. So you have a collection of morphism like that for all objects and for all morphism. You have this commuting diagram checked by this collection of morphism. Now, you see that this morphism is a morphism from f of x to f of x. So it is in this set. But now, f of x, because f is a fiber functor, so it's go to vec, f of x is a vector space. So here, what we get here is just a linear map from this vector space to itself. So it's just, in some sense, a matrix. And so you will use a matrix, so the algebra structure on the matrix, to get an algebra structure on that by taking some limit or some collimit, but here I don't write limit or collimit. This is, I just define it by hand. So the algebra structure of that, so this is just a matrix algebra. This is some M, so matrix algebra, yeah. So this induces an algebra structure here. So how to define an algebra structure? Here you need to have an addition, a multiplication, and a multiplication by a scalar. So you have two natural transformations. How do you add that? But you add the element, the pointwise, the this morphism, this this matrix. How do you multiply that? In fact, you just multiply the matrix, or you compose the linear map. And again, the constant, multiplication by constant, you just multiply by constant the morphism like that. Okay, so here you have details. You have to be careful because you say, okay, you can define this. You have this matrix, you have this matrix, but the question is this collection or this collection or this collection of morphism still provide still a natural transformation? You have to check. You have to check this axiom. That's why I recall this diagram here. And in fact, this axiom are check here. So for the addition, for the multiplication, you just make the decomposition, etc., and everything works well. Okay. So we define the algebra structure. For that, we did not need the Lind tensor product. But for the co-algebra structure, we will need the Lind tensor product. So a co-multiplication is a map from a space to a space tensor with itself. So here, this space H will be this algebra and end of F with L the fiber functor. Now we want to define a structure like that, but for end of F. So how to do that? So first we have this map alpha from end F tensor end F to end of F tensor F. So this map comes from what we did before with the tensor product of functor and the tensor product of algebra of category. So from the definition of the tensor product of functor, you get this map. So F, the tensor product with itself, go from the tensor product of C with itself to VEC. So you get this map alpha. Okay, so now you want to define a map. So you take, so this go from where to where. So you take an element A in end of F, and we want to define delta tilde of A. So this, what is that? So we want to define an element. So you have an element here, and we want to define an element here. So how to do that? So this, the element here, so this, so these are natural transformations from F tensor F, the tensor product F with it. So the tensor product of F with itself. So it's given by two parameters. For two copies here. And you define this as follows. So you consider, so you have this element. So this is a natural transformation. So it's given by a collection with one parameter. But how to get two parameters? In fact, you make a tensor product here. X tensor Y. Okay, so I guess now we are in a, what is this category what is this category? Because we have a tensor product, yes, yeah, you have a ring category. It's a finite ring category, okay. So you can make a tensor product. You have this tensor product, and you apply the the tensor structure of the so G, what is G? I forgot, yeah, this is the tensor structure of the fiber functor here. So you can do that. You can apply the tensor structure of the fiber functor. Here you apply the inverse. Here you, because we know that the tensor structure depends on two variables, and here you have two variables by making tensor product. So you can make as follow, this define a map from the natural transformation of F, from F to F to the natural transformation from F the tensor product with itself. Okay. And finally, we come back to that because we want something from that to that, but we get something from that to that. So we want to come back to here. You just apply the inverse of this alpha here. So like that, you get a map from and F to and F tensor and F. So this is the way to define the co-multiplication structure on and F. And as you see, it requires to use the Dehling tensor product. Okay. And so we have the co-multiplication delta and the co-unit. So the co-unit so it's defined like that. So the co-unit epsilon. So let me recall. The co-unit is something, maybe a map from A to one. So from H to one. So for any element of and F, you associate the, you take the collection of morphism of A and you just consider the morphism given by the unit object. And this is because we are not in a multi-ring category, but in a ring category. So the morphism from the unit to itself is one dimensional space. So it's just a scalar. And it's a way to map H to K like that. So epsilon, this is a co-unit. Okay. So now we get the first theorem. So you take H to be as above. So H is a finite ring category and F a fiber functor. And we get that H, so and of F, is a coalgebra for this co-multiplication and this co-unit. So the existence of a co-multiplication and a co-unit is not enough to get a coalgebra. You need to satisfy some additional. And this co-multiplication co-unit are unital algebra homomorphism. So the point here is, as I said, we need to check some additional assumption on the co-multiplication and co-unit to make it a co-algebra. So the co-associativity follows from the monoidal structure axiom of the tensor structure G. Okay, so here the homomorphism structure, so is proved here, and the unital structure is proved here, so I don't go into the details. Okay, so if you want to go into much more details, you should go to the book on page 12 and 92. Okay. Okay, so so now an algebra definition, an algebra equipped with them. A co-multiplication, a co-unit satisfying the axiom here. So here it's not this, yeah. So if you have an algebra with that, then you have a bi-algebra. Okay. So should I continue? Because if I define too much thing, and then I will have no time to finish. Let me see if I can go up to the first reconstruction theorem. Okay, so let me try. What remind how many? It remind only 2 minutes, so I want to stop here maybe. Okay, so I will just read that. So here you have to understand that as it is proved above, in fact, AND of F has a natural structure of bi-algebra defined as before. So yeah. Okay. So I have no time now, so I will stop here. So let me just, so I will, tomorrow, next week, I will restart from here. But let me just read what we want here. In fact, what is the goal of this section is to state and to review some such reconstruction theorem. In fact, we went from ring category with fiber functor to bi-algebra, but in fact we can come back. It's there is a kind of bijection. This category, the category of so you can go from there to there. Here you have any finite ring category with fiber functor, and you map to this bi-algebra, or you can start from a bi-algebra and you can make the category of representation of this bi-algebra and consider the forgetful functor. And in fact, you can go from one to the other, from the other to one, so it's more or less the same thing. So a bi-algebra is, I will read that next week in a bit more detail. So let me stop here. So I will just write where we stopped here. Yeah. So end of session. Okay.